school attorney, and I talked to a number of people over the last several months and several years about constitutional law issues, and a few folks said, hey, you know, if you're willing to teach that, like, let's put together a little lecture series so that we can create more of a framework on constitutional law. So that's the goal of this. This is part 3 of 6. And I'll kind of summarize where we've been before. I also put this lecture, you know, there's an outline that hopefully everyone got off the back table. It should say lecture 3. And then there's also a notes for a handout for lecture 1 and a handout for lecture 2 as well. I think we still have some copies of those in the back. If you didn't get those and you want to grab them. But I did put the notes online as well. So if somebody's watching this later online, if you go to the website tinyurl.com/constitutionlecture3, like the number 3, then you can download the PDF of these notes and get it that way. All right. Any other kind of preliminary things before we get started? So in the first conversation, first lecture, we talked about the structure of government and the form of government, starting with the American Revolution and states establishing constitutions where the states have this plenary power, this broad police power to do whatever they want that furthers the health, safety, and welfare. They inherited that from the King and Parliament, and then the people of the original states created the federal constitution and the federal government. Federal government is seen as a government of limited power, meaning it can only do, specifically Congress can only do, its enumerated powers. Well, I guess it's true for the executive and the judicial branch as well, federal government. They have limited powers at the federal level. So they're always looking to the federal constitution to say, does Congress have the authority to act? And then, so we looked at the separation of powers within our judicial system. You know, at each level, so at the federal level, there's the president, the executive branch, there's the Congress, which is the legislative branch, and there's the Supreme Court, which is the judicial branch. We also looked at separation of powers between the federal, state, and local governments. So we have a lot of different governments, we have different layers of government. So it's not just separation of powers horizontally, but there's also separation of powers vertically. And so we have federal, state, local governments, and within the state government and even in the local government, we separate out those three functions, you know, the executive, the legislative, and the judicial. So that was a lot of what we talked about in the first lecture. So last week, then, we talked about the judicial branch of government. We're not going to have a separate lecture on the executive and the legislative branch, but specifically on the judicial branch, because the judicial branch has taken on the responsibility of what we call judicial review, the ability to say whether or not an action of the legislature or the executive are constitutional. So that's the famous case Marbury versus Madison in 1803, where the Supreme Court said, we have the power to determine whether an act of Congress is incompatible with the Constitution and whether it exceeds the authority of Congress given to Congress through the Constitution. And that is a fundamental principle that continues through today, in that the judicial branch is the branch of government with the power to say what the law is. We also looked at the problem that the judicial branch runs into, in that it has to police itself. Right? Because the judicial branch says whether a branch of government is exceeding its own authority, or is exceeding its authority, the judicial branch also has to look at whether it's exceeding its authority. And that's led to a whole area of law referred to as justiciability. I always feel like I'm not saying it right when I say justiciability. Which is about whether people are bringing a proper case, whether they have standing to bring it, whether the court has jurisdiction to hear it, whether it's ripe, whether it's not moot, whether it's not a political question, and those sorts of things. So often with cases, and I think we used the Ninth Circuit case concerning the first Muslim ban to say whether, you know, look at how the court was wrestling with whether it could even ask that question of is this constitutional in the first place. So whether the court has to say, sorry, this case isn't justiciable, we don't have the authority to decide this case. So the court is wrestling with that issue as well. So today we're going to move into looking at the separation of powers vertically between federal, state, and local. And today we're going to be putting federal at the top, state, and local. Today's going to be very top-down. It's all top-down stuff. In our next lecture, just to foreshadow things, which is going to be April 20th because we're taking a bit of a break, we're going to be looking at the structure of rights protections in the federal and state constitutions. And that day, we're going to be talking about the federal Bill of Rights as the floor and state constitutions providing greater protection than what the federal constitution provides. So we're inverting that pyramid next week. So that's kind of like the exciting foreshadowing. Today, though, it is top down. It's going to be federal law, Trump's state law, Trump's local law. And that's the way that we think about preemption, that the courts think about preemption, and how this comes to play. So we're looking at this distribution of power, the allocating governing authority, and I'll say power and authority interchangeably, but they're really the same thing as far as we're concerned, between the federal, state, and local governments. So we're looking at vertical federalism, vertical separation of power, and we're not looking as much at separation horizontally like we did last week, but that's going to come in and we're going to see that as well in some of this. If you've got questions or anything, please feel free to ask as we go, but please allow me to say, I don't know, or allow me to maybe defer your question until later, if that's okay. Let's see. Also, constitutional law, perhaps another kind of housekeeping thing, is a huge topic. There's a whole thing here. I mean, we're going to start with the Supremacy Clause of the United States Constitution. It talks about treaties, and we're not even going to just pretend like we didn't even see that, because we're not even going to talk about treaties today. We're not talking about federal Indian law. Not that that's not important, but that's a whole area of law that, in a six-part series, we're triaging. And the focus here is trying to get kind of a grasp of the structure of law. So when we look at a case or when we look at a decision or something playing out in politics today, we have some grounding in why is power working the way it is in that situation. Is that okay? All right. So the basic framework of preemption is really straightforward. And I put in section one of this handout the constitutional provisions that apply for us here in Washington State. The United States Constitution, Article 6, is the Supremacy Clause, and it says, this Constitution and the laws of the United States which shall be made in pursuance thereof, and all treaties made or which shall be made under the authority of the United States shall be the supreme law of the land, and the judges of every state shall be bound thereby, anything in the constitutional laws of any state to the contrary, notwithstanding. So federal law trumps state law. And when the people of Washington enacted the Washington State Constitution, you'll see at the end of that paragraph, we acknowledged that supremacy. So we said in the second part of the Washington Constitution, right after saying that the people have all political power, we said that the Constitution of the United States is the supreme law of the land. So it's like master and servant. You're a subordinate? Yeah, we're subordinate. So that's acknowledged right there in the Washington Constitution. Within Washington's Constitution, then, we have a number of provisions that talk about the power of local governments, specifically cities and counties. So the second paragraph in Washington Constitution, Article 11, Section 10, says that cities or towns heretofore or hereafter organized, and all charters thereof framed or adopted by authority of this Constitution shall be subject to and controlled by general laws, more or less meaning the laws of the state of Washington. And there was this thing back in the 19th century about special laws versus general laws. That's all crazy local government stuff that we don't get into. Any city containing a population of 10,000 inhabitants or more shall be permitted to frame a charter for its own government, consistent with and subject to the constitutional laws of this state. So the charter process is something that came about at the end of the 19th century, where the populist and progressive movements at the time said, we don't like the way that state decision makers are being controlled by corporations. We want more power at the local level. And they said, we want to make local constitutions. We want to be able to create our own definition of what our local government is, and that's a charter. In Canada, they don't talk about constitutional rights, they talk about charter rights, because their Bill of Rights is a charter. So charter, constitution are kind of interchangeable terms. But at the local level, a local constitution is a charter instead of a constitution. That's just the way we use it. So it's a home rule charter. Here in Washington, Clallam County is one of the few counties in Washington State that is a home rule county. So we have our own local constitution for Clallam County. Sitting here in Port Angeles is not a charter city. Instead, Port Angeles gets its governing instructions, its articles of incorporation or bylaws, if you will, from the state. So we are code, as in the state revised code of Washington, for creating the instructions for how the city of Port Angeles is governed.
And what is the November election, that initiative, how is that reversing this idea of charter?
Yeah, so the November election, as far as I understand it, doesn't even address the charter question. There's different forms of cities in Washington, and we're currently a code city, and that's looking at going to a second class city. Neither of those are charter cities. So the easy answer is it doesn't touch charters. The broader thing I'd say is look out probably in the city council packets in the next month or so, because the city is getting some advice and going to hopefully put out a public memo, or I'm not sure if it's going to be public, but they're getting some memos about what the legality is of moving to the second class and how that would work and those sorts of things. So look out for that information, hopefully in the next month or two. I'm not sure exactly when that's going to happen.
Yeah, just if federal law trumps state and local, how can cities become sanctuary cities then?
We're going to get to sanctuary cities at the very end. Yeah, if that's okay. So let's go through, and then we'll hit sanctuary cities at the end. Yeah, but that is an important question to think about. Sanctuary cities, we're going to hit looking at minimum wage laws, and I think there was something else. Well, those are two like kind of hot issues right now that I wanted to put in as case studies. Because I think the larger implication here is that preemption is being weaponized as a way for people to achieve the social agenda that people want to achieve. And there's always been, when we're talking about power, we're talking about conflict as well. And distributing power between the federal, state, and local government is contentious. The courts say that's one of the oldest questions in constitutional law. And the courts will also say, and we think that's going to be the perennial question in constitutional law, is how should we distribute power between the federal and state government? And I'd add in the state and local governments as well. So we also have home rule provisions for counties. I just put in the Article 11, Section 4, third paragraph down of the preemption. There's also this provision where the state constitution gives the police power, that plenary power to make laws to further the health, safety, and welfare of the people, to any county, city, town, or township which may make or enforce within its limits all such local police, sanitary, and other regulations as are not in conflict with general laws. That language sounds very 19th century. Think of the police power as the general power to create laws, and usually it's referred to today as health, safety, and welfare. So whatever includes health, safety, and general welfare. In the past, it included morals and other things that we don't really refer to as the police power anymore. I'm not sure that means they're not there, but the language has changed a little bit. So since the beginning of the United States, the courts have said that this means federal law trumps state law. So Gibbons versus Ogden is one of those cases. This is Justice Marshall again in 1824. Acts of the state legislatures that interfere with or are contrary to the laws of Congress are to be invalidated because in every such case, the act of Congress is supreme. And the law of the state, though enacted in the exercise of powers not controverted, must yield to it. So even though the state has the authority to make that law, right? He's saying, though enacted in the exercise of powers not controverted, even though the state has the authority to make the law, the federal law trumps the state law. Okay. And when we're thinking of the federal law, too, if we go back to thinking about what laws Congress has, often the question to ask is, well, did Congress have the authority to make that law in the first place? So step one is, did Congress have the authority to make that law in the first place? If yes, then, well, does that law preempt that state or local law? But, you know, let's not assume that Congress has the authority, and that's often one of the first challenges to an act of the federal government. So this same principle continues, you know, 150 or more years later, in Gay versus National Solid Waste Management Association, 1992, under the Supremacy Clause, from which our preemption doctrine is derived, any state law, however clearly within a state's acknowledged power, which interferes with or is contrary to federal law, must yield. So it's pretty totalitarian in that, you know, if there's a conflict or if there's preemption, it must yield. So the question isn't so much, you know, what is the preemption principle? It's there in those constitutional provisions, both federal to state and then state to local. But rather, well, when does preemption apply? When is a local law preempted? Right? And that's where people argue, we argue as lawyers, about preemption and what happens there. So there's generally two kinds of preemption. There's either express preemption or implied preemption. So does the legislature say, we're preempting this? Or does the court look at what's going on and say, yeah, we think there's preemption there. That's implied preemption. And then even in express preemption, the court says, we're preempting this. Well, then there's an argument, well, what does this really mean? You know, do they mean, you know, the podium, or did you just mean papers on podium? Because, you know, we can argue about words all we want. So with express preemption, it's really the legislature making an explicit statement. So I pulled some examples from minimum wage laws to use it as an example here. So ORS is Oregon Revised Statutes, and so this is the law, you know, just south of Washington. And this is in the Minimum Wage Act for Oregon. Except as provided in subsection 3 of this section, which really just provides for like wages for employees of cities and stuff like that. The state of Oregon preempts all charter and statutory authority of local governments to set any minimum wage requirements. So if you're in the city of Eugene and you're like 15 now, what are you going to do about that? Are you going to try to pass a minimum wage law in Eugene? No. Somebody said something in the back.
You got to go to the state.
Well, this is saying, you know, assuming that the state has the authority to do that, that the state controls that. The state controls setting any minimum wage requirements. So in Oregon, the folks who are advocating for $15 an hour minimum wage or living wage or family wage, whatever you want to call it, they're not doing a city by city strategy. Their strategy is dictated by Oregon law, and they're advocating for a change at the Oregon level. And they recently did change the minimum wage, and it's starting to go up, similar to how Washington's is going up, although theirs is on a slower timeline. So that's an express preemption provision, and it's that simple, right? And that takes away all the power of the local government to set any minimum wage requirements. So in Washington State, on the other hand, it's completely different. Washington, RCW, Revised Code of Washington, this is the in the minimum wage law of Washington, it says nothing in Chapter 2, Laws of 2017, precludes local jurisdictions from enacting additional local fair labor standards that are more favorable to employees, including but not limited to more generous minimum wage or paid sick leave requirements. So I kind of as clear as the Oregon one, but completely opposite, right? We're saying, here's the state minimum, and local jurisdictions are free to go about it. But we're setting basically a state floor with the state minimum wage law. That's very similar to the minimum wage law at the federal level. So the next one, we have 29 U.S.C. Section 218, subpart A. U.S.C. is United States Code, so the code of the United States, just like RCW is the Revised Code of Washington, the laws of Washington State, the Code of Washington. So in the Fair Labor Standards Act, it says, no provision of this chapter or any other order thereunder shall excuse noncompliance with any federal or state law or municipal ordinance establishing a minimum wage higher than the minimum wage established under this chapter, or a maximum work week lower than the maximum work week established under this chapter. So it's okay to raise the minimum wage, it's okay to decrease the maximum work week. That's what the federal government says. So Congress has said, we're not preempting minimum wage law. Washington State has said, we're not preempting minimum wage law. Local governments in Washington then are free to do what they want with minimum wage, as long as they're going above that federal floor and that state express minimum wage, right? But if you're in Oregon, federal government has said, hey, Oregon, you can set a minimum wage however you want, as long as it's higher than what we've set. And then the state of Oregon says, yeah, we'll do that, and local governments, don't you dare, right? So the local governments in Oregon have been preempted by state law. But they haven't been preempted by federal law, but they've been preempted by state law. So when I say that preemption is being weaponized, I mean that people are saying, oh, this is a powerful tool to prevent certain policies from happening. And minimum wage is a great example of that. That's why I used it. And so I pulled some, what I would say is model legislation. So somebody said, this is legislation that we'd like to see passed. Somebody who did that is the American Legislative Exchange Commission. And this is their Living Wage Mandate Preemption Act. It's basically an act, I didn't include it, I just included the link. But it's basically a model legislation for state legislators to take and put in and pass law at the state level that would stop local minimum wage laws from being enacted. So it would make a state something more like what Oregon has. Oregon's not unique in that regard, but there's Washington, and it's express allowing higher minimum wages at the local level. But we're seeing that this trend of these using living wage preemption as a way to prevent the labor movement advocating for a higher minimum wage from being able to get off the ground. If we think about what happened in Washington, if there wasn't that movement in SeaTac, if there wasn't that movement in Seattle and in other places, would we have grown to the level of moving at the state level? And that's more of a political question than a constitutional law question, but that's where this stuff intersects. All right, anything on the basic framework of preemption there?
Just a point of information, has the ALEC law been suggested on which that needs to be?
There was an article, you can find it if you search preemption and weaponized, I think it was in the New Republic, that was looking at that and said that it looks very similar to that ALEC law. And so for folks who don't know, the American Legislative Exchange Council, or ALEC, invites state legislatures to come, has a lot of very affluent, very conservative donors, and proposes the the stuff and gets it in. An example that's gotten a lot of press is North Carolina's House Bill 2, which was about a year ago, passed through the state legislature of North Carolina. It's referred to as the bathroom bill because the main thing it's known for is saying that people need to use the bathroom that's on their birth certificate. It's also a minimum wage preemption law. So they bundled in some of the economic justice components that are involved in the social movements throughout the United States right now. They bundled that in and passed that as well. So there's this minimum wage preemption in House Bill 2 in North Carolina. I didn't end up putting House Bill 2 on here, even though I promised I would, just because I was like, it's not enough space, and I think this will give you a framework to be able to look at that if you want to examine it more closely. So Rachel, do you remember that?
Years ago in Colorado, they enacted a statewide bill banning granting non-discrimination status based on sexual preference. It was regarded as anti-gay. It was attacked, it was inspired by the city of Boulder enacting its own local ordinance. This did not sit well with the state legislature. They came along with Amendment 2, which was later invalidated by Colorado state courts and by a massive boycott. The result was very similar. People are counting on our one way or the other, in North Carolina.
Yeah, there's several lawsuits. That was another reason I didn't include the North Carolina example, is there's a number of lawsuits right now concerning the bathroom bill. But yeah, Colorado, Romer versus Evans, is the US Supreme Court case deciding that issue in Colorado. And that's a good read if anyone's excited about reading this stuff.
Right, well, just for reference, because there's a lot more press out there. Alec is perhaps better known now than it was 5 or 6 years ago, but that was primarily funded by the Koch brothers and their associates, and that's been the major driver behind it. So when you said it's a very powerful, very wealthy group of people that tend to be right wing, that's putting it pretty mildly. The other thing is, and it's an issue, we know that because of the solar system, there's ALEC legislation in the state of Washington in terms of setting up how local utilities can, and maybe even should, charge for grid-tied solar systems. And ALEC was involved with the, which I think was very closely voted down in Florida. They were trying to pass legislation to make it almost cost ineffective to do private solar systems.
So the comment was about ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange System, and I was minimizing the very wealthy and very conservative when I mentioned he was involved. So it's the Koch brothers. And yeah, their work is more than just minimum wage, but also issues around solar, electric, very much a broad swath of issues. You can probably find model legislation on that website for almost anything you're interested in. Does that sound nice?
That's close. I guess you just kind of understated it, but the ALEC agendas tend to be very, very pro financial elite. Mm-hmm. That's what they're aimed at.
Yeah.
And they spend a lot of money trying to get those proposed legislations enacted in the states.
Yeah. And as we're going to get to, they have help from the structure of preemption, and we'll get into the Commerce Clause as well shortly, which is a special area of preemption. So hopefully that will come up there. I'm going to move on with it. So express preemption, the higher government, the state says to the local, or the federal says to the local, or the state and the local, that, hey, you can't do this, or you can do this. With implied preemption, the court is now coming into the picture a little bit more because the legislators, the lawmakers, haven't expressly said whether the lower law is preempted or not. So now the court's adding more of its opinion into this matter. So we're going back to Gade, the Supreme Court decision from 1992. And they talk about three forms of implied preemption recognized in the case law or by the courts. So absent express preemptive language, we have recognized at least two types of implied preemption. Field preemption, where the scheme of federal regulation is so pervasive as to make reasonable the inference that Congress left no room for the states to supplement it. And conflict preemption, where compliance with both federal and state regulations is a physical impossibility, or where state law stands as an obstacle to the accomplishment and execution of the full purposes and objectives of Congress. So we've got, if we go back a step, express preemption, and then there's an implied preemption, and then in implied preemption, a field preemption, and then conflict preemption, and then within conflict preemption, there's these two different theories that the court uses. Right, so that kind of describes the dichotomous key of the universe of different kinds of preemption. All of this implied preemption requires the court coming in and saying, yeah, it's not totally clear, but we think we know whether that local law can stand or not. Right? And so it has that issue for the court of whether it should be decided policy. Right? Which is said, hey, that's not our job. In this case, they're saying, well, it's unclear, so we need to interpret and say what the law is. So there's an example here that I want to give. I didn't put this on the handout, but the case is State of Washington versus Wauquiacum County. And if anyone knows how to say that county name, that would be
Wauquiacum.
Wauquiacum County. It's a little county of about 4,000 people on the Columbia River, just east of Astoria and west of Longview. Small little county. And Wauquiacum, County decided in 2011 that it didn't want to be spreading the Class B biosolids on fields or anywhere in the county. So backstory here is Washington State in the 1990s said, we're going to have a program for biosolids, which is otherwise known as sewage sludge, and we want to recycle it rather than just throw it away. So we're going to recycle it by treating it up to a certain level and then selling it to people to put on their fields or put in their gardens or other applications like that. So there's different levels. Basically, we can break it into Class A and Class B. Class B biosolids are cleaned of 99% of pathogens, and Class A, according to the state, are cleaned to have no detectable pathogens in them. And there's some other variables in there, but that's basically the gist of it. And Wauquiacum County said, why would we want to have these biosolids that have pathogens in them spread on our fields? And then the field has to be closed for 30 days after that to public access and all sorts of other issues. We're only going to allow Class A biosolids, the ones without any detectable pathogens in them. So they passed that law. And the State Department of Ecology sued the county and said, you can't do that because state law preempts local law. So the state of Washington went to the first side of the handout, the third paragraph down, Washington Constitution, Article 11, Section 11, police and sanitary regulations. No joke intended that this is about sanitary regulations. Any county, city, town, or township may make and enforce within its limits all such local police, sanitary, and other regulations as are not in conflict with general law. The state of Washington said, this is a conflict. We have the system within the state that is a comprehensive system for regulating biosolids, and the local law conflicts with that. And they said it conflicts with it because the state permits biosolid or Class B biosolids to be applied on fields. You can go to the State Department of Ecology and get a permit and then go and spread your biosolids on the field. And the State Department of Ecology said that's the system and we've permitted it, the state has permitted it, and now the county has prohibited it. So if we go back to our rule for preemption at the top of the second page, in the middle of that paragraph, conflict preemption is where compliance with both federal and state regulations is a physical impossibility. The state has permitted it, the local government has prohibited it. That's a conflict, according to the courts. And so the court said, this is a clear conflict case. The local government can't prohibit the Class B biosolids because the state has preempted it. The state has permitted it, the local government cannot prohibit it. So just in the larger context, we have this issue throughout the legal system with regard to environmental law, where we have permits for all sorts of activities that in many cases we said, like if you take the Clean Water Act, that you know, we're going to give these permits until 1984, at which time we won't need to issue these permits anymore because all the streams will be fishable, drinkable, swimmable. That's what the law says.
Yeah, I understand. That's right. It's not real.
And so we issue these permits at the federal level. Well, if the federal government permits it, what do you think the states will have to do? And you can't prohibit it because the federal government's permitted it. So the permitting system in federal law becomes a system of preemption. And that's kind of a tough thing for people to swallow because we put a lot of work and a lot of effort into those environmental laws. I mean, most of these came around in the 60s and 70s and some subsequent to those. But there's this backside to them, which is when we ask the federal government to permit something, and I guess I should add, and we don't include some kind of clause that says, oh, and by the way, this is a minimum standard, and the state can go higher, or the local government can go higher. We have created a situation where a state or local government that wants to create stronger environmental protections is not able to because the federal government has created the ceiling on that protection level.
Yeah. Well, has it ever been challenged in court? Because you're saying the underlying premise, how is this issue valid? You're saying the underlying premise would be the streams and the waters would meet certain standards, and under the 404D and et cetera, they haven't. And so, you know, the premise of that statute doesn't seem to be valid.
Yeah, so the question is, well, the premise of the federal law that, you know, these streams are going to get up to a certain standard seems questionable. I don't know if anyone's made that argument in court. I just haven't perused those cases. I would refer generally a book that is by an environmental law professor out of Oregon, Mary Wood, and her book's called Nature's Trust. And at the first 100 pages or so, look at federal regulatory environmental law. And she looks into that. I don't know if that's going to get the answer there specifically. But yeah, there's this other question of, well, is the federal law even fulfilling its purpose? And that, I think, would be a way to challenge it. You know, in regard to Section 3, again, on the back of the handout, the last section, where state law stands as an obstacle to the accomplishment and execution of the full purposes and objectives of Congress, well, I guess the argument is, well, isn't Congress not fulfilling its purposes and objectives, so the state law is going to fulfill that purpose for the Clean Water Act? I don't know. Is that okay?
You don't know.
All right. So most of preemption law is this debate about, well, what's in conflict? So we say, well, the state law conflicts with the local law. Well, does it? Is it? Why does it conflict? How does it conflict? Can you find a way around that conflict? Is it just that the state law says, you know, a fence around a wrecking yard must be 6 feet, and the local law says the fence around the wrecking yard must be 10 feet? Well, do those conflict? Probably not. You can comply with both of them. Right. So there's a lot of nuance and subtlety within the preemption. The basic principle is there, is solid, that state law trumps federal, or federal law trumps state law trumps local law. But the nuances of, well, what is preemption, when is something preempted, that all is where the debate is. And you look at some cases and you're like, oh, this makes sense. You look at another case and you're like, what? You know, how do you get there? And that's kind of the area of preemption. There is a special area of preemption that I want to talk about, because this gets into some of these issues around the structure of government in the United States. And that's number 4 on the handout, what's referred to as the Dormant Commerce Clause. So if you remember back to Congress having authority under the US Constitution, it's Article 1, Section 8, I think, where it enumerates the powers of Congress. Congress has the power to tax and spend and make post offices and facilitate interstate commerce, right? So generally the courts say, well, we're going to wait until Congress acts, and then we're going to see if that act of Congress preempts a state law, right? In the Commerce Clause context, the courts have said basically that the federal government preempts the field of interstate commerce. And therefore, even if Congress has not acted, even if Congress has been completely silent on this issue, that we can assume that Congress's silence is actually an intent to leave an area of interstate commerce unregulated. Thus, it's a dormant commerce clause. Congress hasn't said anything about that area of interstate commerce, but the courts say that because Congress hasn't said anything, the states still can't do anything in that area. It used to be called the Inverse Commerce Clause, because it's not about Congress's authority to create law under the Commerce Clause. Rather, it's about the state's lack of authority to create a law under the Commerce Clause. And the courts haven't applied this dormant federal power theory to any other area of congressional authority, just to the Commerce Clause. So it's just the Dormant Commerce Clause as kind of a special area.
I'm probably not going to articulate this well, but one of the amendments, I think, says something about anything not claimed by the federal level devolves to the states. The states have all the stuff that the feds haven't claimed. They have it. So this seems to go exactly the opposite.
Yeah, so the question is, isn't there a part of the U.S. Constitution that says that the powers not delegated to Congress are reserved to the states or to the people thereof? Isn't that the 10th Amendment?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's the 10th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. And this seems to go in direct conflict with that.
Correct.
And in preparing today, I did not look at how the courts reconcile the Dormant Commerce Clause with the 10th Amendment. That would be a fascinating research paper, which if anyone wants to do that, I'll give you a few resources to get started. But yeah, those two ideas are definitely, because it's like, well, wait, don't you have to wait for Congress to say something and act before you say that act of Congress preempts a state or a local law? But in the Commerce Clause context, the courts have said we don't have to wait for Congress to act, because the intent of the Commerce Clause is to make sure that there's open commerce. And specifically, the way this is developed as a test is somewhat narrow, so it's not just totally everything. But the basic rule, I just quoted from a constitutional law book with this first quote. So this is kind of how it plays out as a test. So if the court concludes that a state is discriminating against out-of-staters, then there's a strong presumption against the law and will be upheld only if it is necessary to achieve an important purpose. Basically, that means the law is dead. It'll be preempted. In contrast, if the court concludes that the law is non-discriminatory, then the presumption is in favor of upholding the law, and it will be invalidated only if it is shown that the law's burdens on interstate commerce outweigh its benefits. So, for example, let's say we're in New Jersey, and there's these big metropolitan areas all around us, and they're just buying up land and building landfills and exporting all this garbage to us in New Jersey. And we'd rather not be an import, garbage importer. We've done some studies, at the state level, and we actually don't have that much land to even landfill our own garbage, let alone New York's and Philadelphia's garbage. So let's ban their garbage. Anyone want to do that?
Oh, heck yeah.
Anyone think the U.S. Supreme Court is going to let you?
Yeah.
It's kind of an open question. So a lot of these cases are about this, the out-of-state actor. And a number of them are about garbage landfilling pits. So, the court starts by saying, well, is this discriminating? In other words, is it prejudicing somebody who's not in the state? Is it making a distinction between somebody who's in the state and somebody who's out of state? So, in this case, you've got the Pennsylvania Waste Management Corporation wants to import its garbage to Jersey, and same with New York. And so New Jersey is basically discriminating against Pennsylvania Waste Management Corporations and New York Waste Management Corporations in favor of New Jersey Waste Management. And so the court would say, and has said in that situation, well, this discriminates against out-of-state actors. And so then the court moves on to this question of, there's a strong presumption against the law. In other words, the law is probably going to go down in flames. And it will be upheld only if it is necessary to achieve an important purpose. So necessary there is a really strong word. It usually means that there's no alternative way of achieving that purpose. So in most cases, if there's a law that's discriminating against out-of-state actors, the court will invoke the Dormant Commerce Clause. Well, actually, the out-of-state actor will sue in court, saying Dormant Commerce Clause violation, that make that state's law go away. Court will say, well, it's discriminating against the out-of-state actor, in that case, usually the corporate plaintiff, and so we're going to make the state's law go away to end that Dormant Commerce Clause violation. So I think this is an important principle because it affects a lot of what people think about when we're thinking about economic development. We often say, why don't we have more local food at the farmer's market? Can we use government to influence that? Could we say, hey, let's prioritize locally grown food at the grocery stores? Not with the Dormant Commerce Clause. So the Dormant Commerce Clause is really an anti-protectionist interpretation of the Constitution by the U.S. Right? It prevents what we'd say, in international trade, we call it protectionism, or we call them tariffs or whatever. But in the United States, we say it's a discrimination against out-of-staters, right? And the Dormant Commerce Clause is the court's way of striking down tariffs or trade barriers or protectionist measures between different states or even between local governments and states, or anything below the federal level, basically.
So in the example you cited of Pennsylvania and New York trying to take the garbage to New Jersey, would the people of New Jersey have any protection from the other states sending their garbage in their state?
They could do, as far as the Dormant Commerce Clause is concerned, anything that doesn't specifically discriminate against out-of-staters. So, if they said, well, we're going to make sure that there's going to be only a certain amount of garbage being landfilled in our state, that would be fine, as long as they're not prioritizing local garbage over out-of-state garbage, right? But once you start to prioritize what's happening within the state over what's happening outside of the state, this is a general framework, there's a lot of it's like 100 pages in my common law book about the Dormant Commerce Clause. So there's a lot of nuance to it. But the general rule is, if you're starting to prioritize what happens in state against what happens out of state, you're likely in violation of the Dormant Commerce Clause. Yeah. So there's a lot with the garbage cases where they're trying to say, okay, well, how about we do these transfer stations, and everything has to be run through the transfer station. They're trying to find workarounds to the dormant commerce clause problem. And that's something we run into a lot with legislation, where we see legislation that's kind of convoluted and like, isn't there an easier way to do this? And sometimes it's convoluted because there's a certain principle in constitutional law, maybe something like the dormant commerce clause, that they're trying to work around and see if we can we get this passed, the dormant commerce clause, and have it stick as a law without being struck down for discriminating against out-of-staters, for example.
Take the case of transportation of coal from, let's say, Montana to Washington State. Could Washington State, most transports of coal do not cover the coal cars. So could Washington State have a rule that any coal car coming into Washington State must be covered?
We could, and the Federal Surface Transportation Board would say we have exclusive jurisdiction under the Interstate Commerce Commission Termination Act to preempt all local and state laws concerning the movement of goods on rail. So, so that's an express. That is an express and exclusive, like the express term in the Interstate Commerce Commission Termination Act says this is exclusive federal jurisdiction. So kind of like Oregon's minimum wage requirement, but it's like we are having exclusive federal jurisdiction.
So the only way to change that would be to have it be a federal rule that all covers the country.
Well, under the standard theory here, and for full disclosure, I'm representing clients in Spokane who are suing the federal government over that provision. Yeah. And basically, we're saying that the people in Spokane have a right to protect their health, safety, and welfare. And that means that they should be able to regulate fossil fuel trains coming through downtown Spokane. And the federal law prevents them from fulfilling that fundamental purpose of government. So, we'll get the Surface Transportation Board attorney's response in a couple weeks, and they'll be moving to dismiss for sure. So that's good question. I do not plan to in the audience. And that's the sort of thing where preemption, the standard rule in preemption is if the federal government has authority, that's the first question. Does the federal government have authority to make that law? If so, if the federal government says, and we're preempting the field, we are preempting the field of what travels on railroads in the United States, then states have no authority to get involved. That's the standard rule right now. So that lawsuit that I mentioned is trying to say, hey, there needs to be an exception for this when people are trying to protect their health, safety, and welfare.
Well, in that case, you have powerful interests who are in favor of the federal preemption. In the case of marijuana, several states adopted laws conflicting with federal law, and the federal agents have chosen not to do anything about it. And can I assume that's because there's no interest in the federal business realm in forcing them to do something about it?
So the question was, well, in the case of railroads, there's a lot of powerful financial interests interested in what travels on railroads. In contrast, marijuana law, there's now this conflict between, we couldn't go to an election without talking about marijuana. Between the Controlled Substances Act at the federal level and now state law in a number of states. But it doesn't seem like the federal government's really going after that preemption. Is that because there aren't powerful interests looking at that? Is that okay? I can give you my political opinion, but I'll let you form your own political opinion there. Although I would add, in the marijuana business is big business, right? In a state like Washington, where we've done it in a way where there's multiple levels of licenses, that the state is looking at it as a tax revenue interest. And there's lots of corporate interest in saying, oh, now we have a new product, right? It's like the new beer. So it's kind of a big business. So in that way, I would say, I guess answering it, is to me it's almost the opposite in that regard.
Lindsey, just an observation comparing last week's lecture to this week. You talked about judges deciding cases as they want in the common law context. It gets even scarier when you think about Supreme Court appointments and cases decided, and judges deciding cases like they want to in the preemption issue.
So the question is about it's kind of looking even scarier when judges decide in preemption. And if I could add on to that, I think what makes it scarier is in a preemption context, it's not just judges saying, well, here's how the law should develop in this area where we don't really have clear guidance from the code at the state level or the code at the federal level. But in this context, we're actually talking about striking down laws that the people's representatives have put into place, whether it's at the state level or the local level. And so, yeah, it's an issue where we have, you'd think the judges would exercise a lot of restraint on it, because it is striking down laws that have presumably been democratically elected or enacted. Is that a fair way to? Yeah.
I doubt if Gorsuch might.
What's that?
I doubt if Gorsuch will apply that much conservative on issues.
Yeah, so this gets back to that question we had last time. We were talking about judicial restraint, but we were also talking about how judges make law. Right, that Oliver Wendell Holmes said, you know what, it's really what the judge wants to decide, what's convenient for the judge to decide, and then the judge is going to come up with a reason for it and use that reason to make it sound reasonable and rational. There's a saying, well, the outcome of the case might depend more on what the judge had for breakfast than something else, right? And so we see here in the dormant commerce clause, the only area where there's this dormant inverse aspect to it, a preference of the courts to maintain a certain kind of economic system. Right? And we go back to last week, where is it? Oliver Wendell Holmes dissenting in the Lochner case in New York in 1905. That might be a typo, it might be 1906. He's saying this case is decided upon an economic theory which a large part of the country does not entertain. If it were a question whether I agreed with that theory, I should desire to study it further and long before making up my mind. But I do not conceive that to be my duty, because I strongly believe that my agreement or disagreement has nothing to do with the right of a majority to embody their opinions in law. It is settled by various decisions of this court that state constitutions and state laws may regulate life in many ways which we, as legislators, might think as injudicious. So he's saying that we as the court decide whether something is constitutional or not. We don't decide whether it's good policy or not. And for Holmes and for others who are very strict about the court wading into the powers of the democratic branches of government, they say, we don't decide whether the policy is sound policy. You can look at the 2011 opinion in National Federation of Independent Businesses versus Sebelius, which is the Affordable Care Act decision. There's a lot of discussion there about, hey, we're not weighing in on whether the Affordable Care Act is good policy or bad policy. We're just deciding whether it's constitutional, right? Because we're the court, that's all we do. That's what they say, right? The question becomes, is that really all they do? And then we look at the Dormant Commerce Clause, and we're like, really? Is that what you do? So, another example of the Dormant Commerce Clause, this one in the middle of that page, And this is a law that is striking a Connecticut law that required beer companies to declare that their prices in Connecticut were not higher than in the four bordering states. So Connecticut's a pretty small state. It's got four states around it. If you're going to buy beer in Connecticut, you might prefer to drive to an adjacent state, right? Because it's not very far away. Just like people in Washington drive to Oregon to buy your things and then don't declare their use tax when they come back to Washington. Let me give you a quote and I'll get your question. So Connecticut said, well, how about we make the beer companies say our prices in Connecticut aren't any higher than our prices in those other states? And the court said, no. The court said that is influencing the price in another state. So the Commerce Clause precludes the application of a state statute to commerce that takes place wholly outside the state's borders, whether or not the commerce has effects within the state. So the court's saying, well, you're influencing the price of beer in another state. Connecticut, you can only do that in your own state. You can't influence the price of beer in another state. So your law is struck down because it violates the Bill of Commerce Clause.
Just an aside, when I was in college in Connecticut, we didn't worry about the price. We drove to New York because their drinking age was 18.
Great. The point was that the drinking age may be more of a factor than the price, which might explain South Dakota versus, was it Dole? South Dakota versus Dole, which we'll get to in the next section. So that's an example of kind of how far this dormant commerce clause can go in preventing state laws that the courts decide influence commerce in another state or affect interstate commerce. So there's been some judges who don't like the dormant commerce clause. Here's what one of them said. This is the last section of section 4. Our negative commerce clause, so our dormant commerce clause, negative or inverse commerce clause, jurisprudence has taken us well beyond the invalidation of obviously discriminatory taxes on interstate commerce. We have used the clause to make policy-laden judgments. We, the court, have made policy-laden judgments that we are ill-equipped and arguably unauthorized to make. Right? He's saying that the court has exceeded its authority to decide what's constitutional or not, going into the realm of policy, which is the legislator's job, not the court's job. This test, meaning the Dormant Commerce Clause test, surely invites us, if not compels us, to function more as legislators than as judges. So that's a recent case from 1997, and folks may be surprised by who the dissenter is. This is one judge dissenting. All the other eight judges said Dormant Commerce Clause applies to strike down that law. But Justice Thomas said, no, we're acting as legislators when we do this rather than as judges. And that case was saying that property tax, you know, potentially even more interesting if you're thinking about the legal realism aspect of it. He's saying that we should uphold a property tax. Okay? And the eight other justices said that, well, look, that tax has an exception for charitable institutions, but then if the charitable institution primarily serves out-of-state residents, well, then it has to pay the tax. If there's a charitable institution in the state that benefits the residents, it doesn't have to pay the tax. If there's a charitable institution that benefits out-of-staters primarily, it has to pay the tax. And so the court said that discriminates against out-of-staters. So the law is struck down under the Dormant Commerce Clause. And Justice Thomas said, I think we're making policy. I don't think we're judges when we do this.
So what explains in-state versus out-of-state tuition?
Good one.
Yeah, so there is an exception from the Dormant Commerce Clause for government services, I think is the way it's framed. I didn't put the exception in here just because I didn't know how far down the rabbit hole we wanted to go. But generally, there's an exception for government services. So
could that somehow be applied to a landfill situation, that if the landfill was whatever, run by the state, that...
Yeah, if we wanted to parse the landfill cases, we might find that that's something that people have tried. And I don't know what the answer there is as to whether having it be a government service then gets it into the exception. And I feel like I'm not phrasing the exception quite right, but it has something to do with the government can choose to provide services to in-state.
The in-state has been paying taxes.
Right.
That may be tied in with it.
So we're paying taxes, so we can get something for that. Yeah. But even if you're not paying taxes, the court will say, you know, hey, it's okay that you provide that service for your residents in the state. So there's it's not a totalitarian doctrine. I mean, it's really about this discrimination, and then we then get into the necessary to achieve an important purpose. So there are ways to get through that, and there are exceptions that the court has set up. But the general principle is what we've laid out here, which is a state cannot do protectionist measures or other kinds of activities that benefit in-state economic actors over out-of-state economic actors. There's another principle that's a limitation here, kind of like the Dormant Commerce Clause that I didn't put on, but it's the Privileges and Immunities Clause in the Fourth Amendment to the United States. And the court basically says that, in a way, like the Dormant Commerce Clause, that Privileges and Immunities Clause prevents a state from discriminating against an out-of-state actor's economic livelihood or something like that. So it's very similar to the Dormant Commerce Clause, but the theory is somewhat different. But I should just note that that's in this area of law as well. But it's kind of nuanced and really subtle, and I didn't include it for today, if that's okay.
Could you just say something a little bit? We're all facing possible big changes in healthcare. Washington State has a very liberally interpreted form of licensing insurance companies to operate in this state. They have to provide a slew of things in their plans. The Trump Care plan wants to have health insurance companies be able to market their stuff across states. So does that mean that Washington State, all our rules about what needs to be in health insurance, will go out the window?
So the question was about health insurance policies that Washington State requires healthcare providers, healthcare insurance companies to provide a lot of benefits or cover a lot of different claims. And the proposal coming out of Congress right now is saying, well, we want insurance companies to be able to reach multiple state markets. Is that okay, Summer? I think the short answer is we don't really know whether that's going to be constitutional until a judge says whether it's constitutional or not. I think there is some guidance in the National Federation of Independent Businesses case from 2011 in what Congress's authority is. But here we're talking about something a little bit different in, what does that do for Washington State? If I was a strategist on Capitol Hill right now trying to get rid of the Affordable Care Act, I would say, let's preempt the field of health insurance regulation at the federal level. If that's your goal, because then you can cut off these states, and this isn't really what I want, just to clarify. Then you can cut off these states that are moving toward the single payer system if you don't like single payer insurance, and say, hey, does Congress have authority to regulate health insurance? Yeah, probably. So can we then free up the field of health insurance regulation? Sure. And then these states that are moving towards single payer or providing Medicaid for too many poor people, we can kind of get rid of that. We're getting a lot of questions, and I'd love to explore this more, but I really want to get to common year. Sorry, I'm going to cut you off. So commandeering, I forgot to put on this handout the 10th Amendment, but that's where this principle is coming from. And this is kind of a counter to that overall totalitarian nature of preemption, that the federal government, if it has authority, can say, we preempt the field. Right? Health insurance regulation, well, we're going to preempt the field. Minimum wage law, hey, let's preempt the field. Environmental regulation, hey, let's preempt the field. Let's not let the states decide any of this stuff, because then it creates a patchwork, and that's confusing. So that's the theory for how they explain the policy behind preemption. So with commandeering, though, we have this idea that we have primarily two, and then a lot of local governments, but two governments. And the courts say, sometimes without explaining it, that we think that having two different governments, federal government and state government, gives people more freedom and more liberty than just having one, because it divides the power more, right? Going back to separation of powers, vertically and separation of powers horizontally. So that's where the commandeering principle comes from. And this first one is a case from 1997. And I don't even remember what this is. This is a case where the federal government said that we want local law enforcement to enforce federal handgun laws and do checks and all sorts of other things. So we at the federal level are going to tell local law enforcement what to do. We're going to give them instructions, right? And the court said, federal Congress can tell the federal executive branch what to do, but this is the federal Congress telling the state executive branch, more or less, what to do. And the court said, Congress cannot compel the states to enact or enforce a federal regulatory program. Congress cannot circumvent that prohibition by conscripting the state's officers directly. The federal government may neither issue directives requiring the states to address particular problems, nor command the state's officers or those of their political subdivisions, cities and counties, to administer or enforce a federal regulatory program. It matters not whether policymaking is involved, and no case-by-case weighing of the burdens or benefits is necessary. Such commands are fundamentally incompatible with our constitutional system of dual sovereignty. So, Congress can't say, hey, we want state law enforcement or local law enforcement to enforce federal handgun law. That was the Prince versus the United States case. There was an earlier case in the 90s where Congress wanted states to regulate low-level radioactive waste. So Congress passed a law that said, if states don't have a policy for regulating low-level radioactive waste by this date, a year or two from now, then we require the states to take ownership of that waste. And the court said, that's commandeering. That's not allowed. So the commandeering principle is kind of coming from this idea of the federal government. Let me back. There's an intersection here between the spending clause and the 10th Amendment and kind of how all that fits together. So in some of these cases, it's about whether Congress has gone too far in its spending clause authority. Right? There's not a dormant spending clause, but one of the enumerated powers that Congress has is to spend. And so Congress often allocates funds to the states. So there's a case, I forget when, but this is a decade or more ago, where the federal government said, hey states, if you don't raise your drinking age to 21, we're going to cut 5% of your federal highway funds. And most of the states said, okay. And South Dakota said, we're going to sue you to the federal government. And so South Dakota sued and said, you can't do that to us. You're controlling us. And the court said, yeah, when Congress exercises its spending clause authority, it is kind of contracting with the states. So contract law is a whole other body of law. It'd be a fun thing to talk about because we do it all the time. We all have contracts. And so in contract law, a contracting party can't exert undue influence over the other party, right? You can't say, you know, either sign this contract or I'm going to take your baby. You know, like something like that. That's not allowed. Do this or, you know, we're going to throw rocks through your windows. You know, no undue influence, right? So Congress can't do that to the states when it's asserting its spending clause power. So the courts in that 5% highway commission or highway funds in exchange for a rise in the minimum wage, our minimum drinking age, the court said, well, we don't think that's undue influence. It's only 5% of the budget. It's not really going to break the bank. In South Dakota, it's less than 1% of your overall budget. That's not undue influence. You know, you can choose to walk away from that, and it's not like you know, the state budget would go away. Sorry, I was about to say something I probably didn't want to be. On the other hand, there's a recent case which didn't make it on the handout, but I referred to it a few times, the Affordable Care Act case, National Federation of Independent Business versus Civilis. And in that case, the US Supreme Court said, yes, most of the Affordable Care Act is under Congress's authority under the taxing clause or some other clauses. Well, they were looking at the individual mandate, the requirement to have insurance or pay taxes, or pay a fee, basically. Have insurance or pay a fee. And the court said that is constitutional, as in Congress has the authority to make that law under its taxing power. But then there's this provision in the Affordable Care Act where Congress is requiring states to expand their Medicaid eligibility requirements so that rather than just very select groups of poor people having access to Medicaid, it is all people under 133% of the federal poverty level are eligible for Medicaid. And initially, Congress is going to pay 100% of that, but then starting, you know, it was maybe 6 years or so after the Affordable Care Act passed, Congress would start to back off and the states would have to start to pay an increasing amount of that expanded Medicaid cost. And that is something that the US Supreme Court said was commandeering. So the US Supreme Court upheld most of the Affordable Care Act, but it struck the Medicaid eligibility expansion, saying that the funding scheme that Congress had created was undue influence. Chief Justice Roberts said it was like a gun to the head of the states. Sorry. And so Chief Justice Roberts, with a majority of the court behind him, said that, you know, this is undue influence. This isn't something that the states could say, yeah, we don't want to do that. We're going to do it our own way. You can't commandeer us. You can't control it. It's like, no, you either play or, you know, you're done. Your budget's gone because you would have lost all of their Medicaid funding if they didn't comply with that mandate of the Affordable Care Act. It wasn't 5%. Like South Dakota versus Dole, it was the entire Medicaid. So the court said that's undue influence and that is commandeering. So there haven't been a lot of cases on this commandeering doctrine, but we're probably going to see some with regard to sanctuary cities. Mm-hmm. So sanctuary cities takes a lot of different forms, but generally what's happening now is that local governments, potentially even state governments. Have states passed this yet? There's been some discussion of sanctuary states. I think California has introduced it, but I don't remember if it's passed or not. Saying we're not going to cooperate with federal immigration enforcement. Mm-hmm. Right? Immigration is federal business, not a state business. Sorry, I'm going to hold that question here.
I just want to know, they're not sure if they're not cooperating with federal ordinance.
Yeah. And part of that, maybe that, I don't want to infer what the sheriff's motive is, but part of that is in Washington and other places on the West Coast, it's not legal for somebody to be held in jail for an immigration or a prospective immigration violation. You know, there's a due process issue there. So a lot of the law enforcement watching are like, hey, we can't comply with this because we're violating people's due process rights by holding them in jail if they haven't committed a crime or they've been able to post bail or whatever. So there's a subtlety here with that. But so the federal government issued an executive order at the end of January talking about sanctuary cities and saying, hey, sanctuary cities, you're not gonna get funding. Right? We're gonna cut you off from federal funding. And then they amended that executive order and they included a citation to an act of Congress. So at the bottom here, we have 8 U.S.C. section 1373. So this is a section of immigration law passed by Congress. And it says, notwithstanding any other provision of federal, state, or local law, a federal, state, or local government entity or official may not prohibit or in any way restrict any government entity or official from sending to or receiving from the Immigration and Naturalization Service information regarding the citizenship or immigration status, lawful or unlawful, of any individual. So that's federal law. And then you've got cities, maybe even states, passing a number of different laws of different varieties, I'm not saying they're all the same, that in many ways say we're not going to share information with federal immigration officials. Right? So, is there conflict?
Oh, heck yeah.
Seems like there's a potential conflict. I'm going to have to hold that question just because we're going to need to end shortly. So I did a little bit of research on this, and I'm not saying that this is comprehensive in any way, but I wanted to see if there were any cases right on point with this question. And I did find one back in 1999. It's at the end of that paragraph. It's the City of New York and Mayor Rudolph Giuliani joining the City of New York versus the United States. And basically in New York in 1989, a former mayor had issued an executive order for the city saying that it was not allowed for city government employees to voluntarily provide information to Immigration Naturalization Services. And so then in 1996, the federal government passed this law, 8 U.S.C. 1373, and so the City of New York and Rudolph Giuliani sued federal government saying, your statute that says that we have to provide this information is facially unconstitutional. And what that means is that the statute has to go away completely. It's facially unconstitutional. Just on its face, it's illegal. And they cited commandeering as their main theory, right? And the court said, and this isn't the U.S. Supreme Court, this is the Second Circuit, so that's the 2D CIR, Second Circuit, so not the trial court, the Court of Appeals, before the U.S. Supreme Court. The Second Circuit heard the case and said, this is a facial challenge, and in a facial challenge you have a really high burden of showing the unconstitutionality of a law. Basically it means you need to show that there's no possible set of circumstances where that law could be constitutional. And in this situation, the Second Circuit said, we don't really see that. We think that this federal statute, you know, that there's some other reasons here. I mean, basically the Second Circuit is saying, you're trying to intentionally not cooperate with federal law. And the Second Circuit saw this New York executive order as an act of collective civil disobedience, kind of. I mean, they're saying kind of collective disobedience. And they said that they didn't think that really, really made muster. It's not the best case in terms of like the quality of the legal thinking, if that's okay to say. I'm not trying to criticize the judges, but like It's not a case that I think is really determining this issue in something like some of these other cases that we talked about. So I threw that in there just because I found it, and it's directly on point to this question. But the sanctuary city stuff is a live issue. And it's going to depend in many ways on how the laws are phrased at the local level. It's going to depend in many ways on who the judges are looking at these issues. But this is the framework in which we're dealing with that issue, whether it's a local, county, state, or national level.
Lindsey, what constitutional provision was the Prince case decided on?
That's the 10th Amendment. So Prince is decided under the 10th Amendment.
Does that not apply to the statute down below?
So, City of New York versus United States, the Second Circuit said the 10th Amendment didn't apply to that statute. I'm not saying I've done a comprehensive review of that statute. It was probably a 10-minute search. But that's what that circuit said back in 1999. And I think, you know, there's potentially more on what the law is. I will say there's an article in the Washington State Bar Association newsletter. You can find it online at nwlawyer, like northwestlawyer.wsba.org. And in the latest edition, I think it's page 44, there's an article summarizing a lot of the immigration law stuff. It's written by one of the attorneys at Northwest Immigrant Rights Project. It's an advocacy piece, so it's laying out one view on it. But if you're interested in that issue, that's a place to look. And that's partly where some of this discussion came from, although he didn't cite this case. I'm going to have to take questions at the very end. I'm sorry about that. But I just want to say we're going to take a break in these lectures. And so we're going to go April 20th is our next lecture, so number 4. And that's going to be about rights protections in the federal constitution and state constitution. We're going to lay out the framework for due process, equal protection, and how courts decide whether a government action violates people's individual rights. April 27th, we're going to look at a specific subset of rights dealing with protesting and privacy. And then May 4th, we're going to cover a topic that is not typical in the general constitutional law course of study, but we're going to look at how corporations use constitutional rights in order to do what they do. So more than what we've covered here. So just to say, these first few lectures were more about the structure of government. But one thing I want to point out is that the next three about rights, they intersect together. And you know, we've been dealing with the way that the court, you know, controls or decides who gets to make law, who gets to make law about what, and then things like the Dormant Commerce Clause, where the court is saying that we're going to strike down state laws or local laws, even though the federal government hasn't acted. We think the federal government doesn't want that. So there is this issue alive and well in preemption, and we'll get to that again, you know, in the next three, about what is the role of the court? How much should the court play this role in policing what the people, or the people's representatives, decide to enact this policy? So thank you so much for this.